Welcome to worship. We're so glad you're here with us today online. As always, we pray that we experience the presence of Jesus together as we worship. Just a few notes of what's coming up before we get into worship. This Thursday, Maundy Thursday, we'll have drive-through communion from 3 to 4:30. We'll also have an online devotional posted that night. On Good Friday, our worship service will be online. On Saturday, the Saturday of Easter weekend, we'll have a drive-through passion story from 3:30 to 5 p.m. right here in our parking lot. And then on Easter, we'll have worship online, but we'll also have three worship services on the lawn at 6:30, 8:30, and 10 a.m. Now let's begin worship in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You're good. Oh, Please join me in a word of prayer. Triumphant Lord, we rejoice in your entry into the world and into our lives. Joining with the crowds, we sing your praises and exalt your reign. But even so, our hearts are far from true worship. Our minds are distant from true understanding. We're disappointed with your humility. We're uninspired by your selflessness. Our sin leads us to give you death, even though you give us life. Our treachery guides us to war, even though you call us to peace. Help us to reflect in our lives the glory of your Son and to live faithfully here and now. Have mercy on us, Savior of all. Find us in these forsaken places. Forgive us what we have done and who we have been. And bring us home again. And impart within us a new song of joy and celebration. And all God's children say, Amen. On this Palm Sunday, Passion Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week, our gospel text comes from the Gospel of Mark, the 14th chapter, beginning with the 32nd verse. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible this hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not my will, but what you will." And then he returned to his disciples, and he found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more he went away and prayed, and the same thing happened. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy, and they didn't know what to say to him. And returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough! The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." The Gospel of our Lord.
I took a class in centering prayer, a form of Christian meditation, a few years ago. One of the exercises we were supposed to practice regularly was to pick a word that had some sort of spiritual meaning for us, like peace, love, joy, maybe the name Jesus, then sit alone in a dark, quiet room and meditate on that one word or a short phrase. Repeating this word would allow us to clear our mind and make room for us to listen to what God had to say to us. Now, some days that worked for me. Other days, sitting alone quietly in a dark room meant I was taking a nap. In other words, sometimes I didn't do any better than Jesus' disciples did in the Garden of Gethsemane. This Sunday is the day that the church calls Palm Sunday, but in many churches, it's called Passion Sunday. And worship includes a lengthy reading of the entire Passion story. The passage we read from Mark today, that Pastor Bob read from Mark today, is part of the Passion story. Jesus and his disciples have eaten the Last Supper, and they go out to the Mount of Olives, where Jesus wants to be alone with his disciples and with God and pray. Jesus is intentionally taking time away from the busyness, the hustle and the bustle of the Passover week celebration to spend time with his disciples, then spend time quietly in prayer with God the Father. This is one of Jesus' common practices throughout the Gospels. We could even call it, I suppose, a spiritual discipline. Like prayer, reading scripture, fasting, confession, and worship, spending time with God in silence is a way of focusing on your relationship with God. You might think that silence, especially if you're spending some of that silent time praying, is really just the same thing as prayer. But it's at least a little bit different. Or maybe it's better to say that it's a special form of prayer. My friend Sam passed away several years ago. He once told me that he spent quite a bit of time praying, but he never heard God answer. I knew Sam pretty well. He had a gift of gab, and he had made a good career in sales. Apparently, he could just keep talking until you gave up and bought whatever he was trying to sell you. Man, he could talk. Even more than some pastors I know. So I asked him if he ever stopped talking enough when he was praying to listen. That hadn't ever occurred to him until I asked the question. There in the Garden of Gethsemane, on the Mount of Olives, Jesus has quiet time with God the Father. He asks the Father if it is possible that he could be spared the suffering that he knows is coming. But then Jesus turns it back to the Father. Not what I want, but let your will be done. I'm convinced that it was in creating a space of silence and then listening that Jesus found the answer to his question about God's will. And that act of listening requires silence on our part. It requires tuning in. Most of us have a favorite radio station, maybe a favorite channel on Sirius XM or on some other streaming service. But if we don't turn it on, if we don't tune it in, we can't hear it. And if we're talking instead of listening, whatever it's playing doesn't have much impact on us. Listening to God is like that. In 1 Kings chapter 19, the prophet Elijah has just confronted King Ahab and the false prophets of the false god Baal, or some people pronounce that as Baal. Elijah has prevailed in this contest, but he's exhausted and he flees for his life to Mount Oreb. Picking up in 1 Kings chapter 19 at verse 9, we read, "And the word of the Lord came to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' Elijah replied, 'I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too.' The Lord said, 'Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by.' Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' Elijah is all alone on a mountain, in silence. And the Lord spoke to Elijah out of the silence, not out of the wind or the earthquake or the fire. Out of the silence, Elijah heard a whisper. And if we had read the rest of the chapter, we would have seen that God's whisper gave Elijah directions as to what to do next. Silence is difficult in today's world. It seems like, at a minimum, there's always an electrical hum somewhere from some appliance or some machine, or a ringing telephone. My house backs up to a hill that leads up into a mountain range, so there's not much noise coming from the backyard, except for some birds. But there's often all sorts of noise coming from around the neighborhood. And yet God calls us to silence. To quote St. Augustine, "Thou hast made us for thyself, and our hearts are restless until they find rest in thee." As A.W. Tozer has pointed out, there is a commonly held idea that song, music, is the highest form of expression of joy in the Lord. Martin Luther, for example, said that when we sing hymns, we pray twice, once with the words, once with the notes. After all, Luther said, the gift of language combined with the gift of the song was only to let us know that we should praise God with both words and music, namely by proclaiming the word of God through music. The Psalms tell us that all creation praises the Lord and sings for joy. Luke tells us that as Jesus was entering Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, the crowd was loudly rejoicing and praising God, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." When the Pharisees wanted Jesus to tell the crowd to be quiet, he replied that if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. Sometimes loud music and shouts of praise and hosanna are the correct response. But as Tozer also points out, moments of silence sometimes reflect or even accomplish our greatest connections with the presence and the glory of God. When the Holy Spirit is permitted to exercise his full sway in a redeemed heart, there will likely be valuable spoken praise first. We often see this in the book of Acts, for example. But Tozer goes on, "Then, when the crescendo rises beyond the ability of studied speech, comes song. When song breaks down under the weight of glory, then comes silence, where the soul, held in deep fascination, feels itself blessed with an inutterable beatitude." Silence and the presence of God. Sitting in silence might seem awkward at first. When I was in high school, I dated once a girl who I had known for a few years and considered a good friend. But it turned out that night, we didn't have much to talk about, and we spent quite a bit of time in awkward silence. I decided that putting either one of us through that again was not worthwhile. But consider the contrast between that kind of silence and the kind of silence that you might have with your spouse, a parent, or one of your adult children. Maybe you sit together in silence because you don't need to talk to each other. Maybe one or both of you are reading or knitting or something, but maybe you're just both sitting there. It's not awkward, it's just nice to sit together. And you don't have to have something to say. You just want to experience each other's presence. Sitting alone with God can be like that. I told you earlier that I took a class in centering prayer a few years ago. I also took a class in Christian meditation when I was in college. That was more than a few years ago. Bradley Hansen, the Lutheran theologian from whom I had taken one of my required religion classes, had gotten interested in a controversial practice called transcendental meditation, based on Eastern philosophy and some ideas out of Hinduism, and then made famous, of course, by the Beatles. Hansen, after spending some time doing research, learned that the practice of meditation had a long history in the Christian church, but that it had largely been ignored by Protestants in Western Europe and North America. So he set out to recover a practice of Christian meditation as silent prayer. "The idea," he said, "is to sit quietly alone for 20 or 30 minutes and clear your mind in one way or another in order to focus on the experience of God's presence. If God has something to say to you that day, the silence on your part makes room for that. but maybe you'll just experience God's presence. Or maybe you'll take a nap, which is okay too, because that means you needed the sleep. Scholars say that any kind of meditation practiced daily is good for your health. But Dr. Hansen found particularly Christian benefits to a Christian practice of silent meditation. This Christian meditation, or form of silent prayer, involves some form of spoken or unspoken words as a way to get focused. You may have one word you use all the time: love, joy, peace, the name Jesus, etc. A common practice for centuries in certain monasteries was to spend some time each day reading a short Bible passage over and over again, each time focusing on a shorter and shorter portion of the passage until you got down to one word or a short phrase, and then repeat that word or phrase as a way of settling your mind and guiding your prayer time. Finally, there's a practice that goes back at least 1,500 years, and it's the repetition of what is known as the Jesus Prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Dr. Hansen settled on this short prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Why don't you say that with me? I know you're wherever you're watching this video, and here I am in the sanctuary, but say this with me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And he found this practice, 20 or 30 minutes of silent prayer, following that short prayer, helpful in many ways. First, it helped his relationship with Jesus. Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is our Lord, the one who is truly our Redeemer King. When this practice makes us aware of his presence, our natural inclination is to worship and adore him and to obey him. Being aware of the presence of Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit changes our lives. And Dr. Hansen found this nearness to Christ changed his attitudes. And eventually, because attitudes affect our behavior, this nearness to Christ changed his actions, the way that he lived. Now, I suppose I should have asked his wife or one of his children to check and see if this was true. But Dr. Hansen, the Lutheran pastor and theologian, believed that up until this point in his life, he had been trying unsuccessfully to be a better person. But he also believed that as he began the discipline of regularly spending time in silent prayer to Jesus, he slowly and gradually became more Christ-like. Isn't that really what we want? Sometimes we focus on forgiveness to the exclusion of the changed life that is available because of Jesus. Forgiveness is a wonderful thing. Being forgiven gives us a chance to start over. And I need that chance every day. But the point isn't just to be forgiven. It's also to start over. And when we start over, hopefully we get better at loving God and loving our neighbors. In other words, becoming more Christ-like, which, Dr. Hansen concluded, we would never really do all that well on our own. But when we spend time with Jesus, who is holy, his holiness will rub off on us. And over time, as we spend more time with him, we become more like him, better at loving God and better at loving our neighbors. Over these past several weeks, we've looked at several Christian practices, several spiritual disciplines: prayer, Bible reading, fasting, confession, worship, and today, silence. I suppose I should just stop talking for a couple seconds, shouldn't I? These are all different ways of walking with or spending time with Jesus. If you don't regularly practice silent time with Jesus, I encourage you to give it a try and see what happens. My experience has been that sometimes I will engage in this kind of practice for a month or 6 months or a year or two at a time. And then for a while I won't. I'll be doing some other sort of practice. And then I'll come back to this spending quiet, silent time with Jesus. And I would suggest that if you want to give this a try, commit to practicing this form of prayer for at least 2 weeks or maybe a month. Try to do it every day or almost every day. Find a time and a place that work for you. Maybe a particular room in your house, maybe even a particular chair or a seat. Get comfortable and relaxed. Unless you live alone, you can't protect yourself from all interruptions, but do the best you can. And then spend some time reading a short scripture passage. Then say this short prayer a few times. Say this with me now. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. One more time. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Then spend 10, 15, 20 minutes in silence. If you get distracted, repeat that short prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Wait for Jesus to show up and change your life. Amen.
Hi, I'm Rachel, and I'm the Director of Student Ministries here at Messiah. Our small groups for junior high and high school have been thriving throughout this entire time, and especially this school year. Our confirmation small groups are going to wrap up in about a month, but we are so excited to have Student Ministries back on Sunday, starting Sunday, April 11th. We're going to start on the North Lawn and move into the Youth Center for a time of teaching and small group time. We're still going to be practicing everything that keeps us safe, but we are so excited to gather all of our students back together again. In this time, we've also been planning for an amazing summer, and I can't wait to share all of that going on with you. So make sure you're following us on our social media and checking the website and reading the Messiah emails to get all of the updates. Our students are truly some of the best people in the entire world, and I can't wait for you guys to see everything that they've been up to this year.
Thank you, Rachel, for that love moment. As we move into our offering, I would like to just take some time and share with you a little about our Easter donation and the program that we want to contribute to once again this time of year. We're highlighting Matthew and Melissa Stock. They are part of an organization called AIM, Agape International Missions. The Stocks have been part of our Messiah family and support since 2013. And over these past 8 years, they've been working in Cambodia in a very important and risky ministry. They take the young girls who are trapped in the sex trafficking industry and rescue them, and then train them up, give them an education, give them some life skills, and raise them with the love of Christ, putting them back out into the world and into the community with ways to support themselves and their families. And so we ask for your continued not only prayer support, but also financial support for the Stocks and their ministry. We thank you also for your offerings. Thank you for all the generous gifts of your time, of your talents, as well as your financial resources. These gifts are part of our response to what God has already done for us. Your gifts allow us to continue to reach out to others and to share the transforming love of Jesus through youth ministry, children ministry, through outreach ministries like the Stocks are involved with. Your faithfulness and generosity, especially during this time of pandemic, has been so critically important. And I just want to remind you of the various ways that you can make a regular or weekly financial gift to Messiah. You can go online and just follow the prompts on our website. You can go online through your bank. You can drop off your offerings on Monday mornings at our Caring Hands Food Pantry food drop-off from 9 to 11. Or you can mail your offerings into Messiah at 4861 Liverpool Street, Yorba Linda, California, 92886. And once again, just a huge thank you from the bottom of our hearts for allowing us to continue using your resources to reach others with the love of Jesus. Please join me now in a word of prayer. Gracious God, Palm Sunday is here. The week of the Passion is upon us. And this year, this past year, has brought tumultuous times and flashes of fear that none of us may have experienced in our lifetime. The very real fallen state of our world and frailty of life have been put out in front of us, front and center, in very visceral ways, even over this past week with the mass shootings in Atlanta and in Boulder. We pray today for the victims, their families, their communities. We see the frailty of life these days from all of the loss and suffering from COVID, not to mention the non-COVID related losses and pain in people's lives. We look to you, good and gracious God, this day and every day, to guide us out of our fear and remind us of our Savior. We do not need to be afraid. You have given us the wisdom that we need to live each day of our lives to the full purpose you've designed for us to live. Help us to listen, to be silent, so that we can hear your word. Lord, Palm Sunday is the reminder of the unexpected, yet fully anticipated King of Kings. Jesus, you didn't look like the Messiah. You didn't look like what people had hoped for. The way you entered the holy city of Jerusalem on that day, riding on a donkey, was a significant sign of peace and fulfillment of prophecy, yet it didn't align with their expectations of a military conqueror. Lord, much of our daily lives don't align with our expectations either. So much of our lives don't make sense. This Palm Sunday, this Passion Sunday, let us embrace the unexpected entrance of you, our Savior. You are the bringer of peace. And let us apply this incredible truth to our lives. Peace mattered to you, Jesus. You came to bring us peace. Gracious God, how quickly we forget the peace which we possess in you. Remind us minute by minute, day by day, as we navigate difficult days and trying times. Lord Jesus, we need peace to live life to the full. You died for us so that we might live lives filled with your peace. In your name we pray. And now we join together in praying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to know you more. We're hanging on every word. Thank you. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to know you more. We're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. And when you come into the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. You're changing everything. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we're leaning into all you are. Everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts. Come now and have your way. 'Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. And when you come into the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. You change everything. And when you
We're so glad you've joined us for worship today. For the last several weeks, we've been looking at questions of spiritual disciplines, practices that help us walk with Jesus and experience his presence. Next week, on Easter Sunday, Pastor Bob will be preaching on the topic of who are you looking for? And the next week, the next Sunday, we'll begin a new series looking at the question of who is Jesus? Seeing who it is that the Gospels tell us he is. I hope that you will join us next Sunday for Easter and that you'll join us after that for our continuing series as we look at who Jesus is and what he means for our life. Now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.